Hi, I'm Simon James, and today I'm going to show you how to use the little butterfly keys we made in the last video to make a really strong corner joint. Now these guys are quite small, and so to explain how these things actually work, I made a wooden model. And if you remember in the last video, we cut a slight taper on the sides of this little key here, marking the top and the underside very clearly. And the reason for that is, as it fits into the join, the taper allows it to slide in and travel. And for that reason, it's really important to chisel in some extra space for this to slide into. So that as it moves down, it then puts a tension force on the joint and actually pulls the joint together. Now, imagine that happening from both sides. As the butterfly key is then pushed in, the joint just gets pulled together very tightly. Now there's no need to beat this thing into oblivion, just a gentle tap and some glue, and that is strong enough. Don't expect it to go all the way and be flush with the surface, because what I do in practice is just get a saw and cut it off and then plane it flush. And it's just the same with these little fellas here. I've made these deliberately deeper than what I actually need for the purposes of just cutting the top off when I'm done, as it gives a very neat finish. Now remember, what we're doing here is producing a glued up piece of cornice. And so that's going to be made out of two parts. And I'd recommend that you do this butterfly key operation on both parts before you join it together. Because that way, when it is finally glued in place, you end up with a very strong joint with altogether four butterfly keys holding it together. And I think that's the best way of doing it. But the first thing we need to do is to cut our mitres. And we'll do that now. Now you could chop up the moulding use an electric saw. I'm going to use a mitre box and a bench hook to support the work. This is all part of a system which works really nicely. So I just use a nice sharp dovetail saw and make sure that I always cut towards the moulding and not away from it, which would break the fibres away. Yeah, that's the first piece done, and the second piece I'll cut from the other direction. Again, it's really important to hold this nice and still, and just take your time. Now it's important just to keep your saw nice and level as you go down, otherwise you'll end up digging into your bench or snagging the back of your mitre box, so just watch out for that. Well, that's a reasonably good fit, straight out the mitre box. But to get it absolutely perfect, I'm going to use a mitre shooting board. It's really important to use a freshly sharpened plane for this, because otherwise the fibres won't cut cleanly at all. And also make sure that the iron is set absolutely parallel to the sole of the plane. And the reason for that is, if it's not, what you'll end up doing is planing a slight chamfer on the end of your mitered moulding, and you don't want that at all because it won't fit properly. Now, I've actually got a plane towards the moulding here, which has actually got a fragile edge, and because the plane's so sharp, and the birch that I'm using has got a fine grain, this works reasonably well. However, on some woods with some sort of moulding, you may not be able to do this at all, and you may find that just planing it, even with a sharp plane, is going to break out those fibres. In that case, what you could do is something different. Now, this is a shop-made device. What it is a piece of wood with some sandpaper on each side. I've used the belt of a sanding machine actually, and just glued it to it and fixed it on both ends. And I've got 120 here, and I've got 60 grit on the other side, which will take the stock off a lot faster. And what you'll find is that this gizmo will actually do the same kind of job as a plane, but rather than just breaking out the fibres on difficult wood, it'll leave a lovely crisp edge no matter which way you move it. And so that's a great way of getting out of trouble. Now, the next thing we need to do is to fit the butterfly keys. And to do that, I've got another little jig, and I'll show you that now. Now, the nice thing about this jig is it's really easy to make and very easy to use. It holds the work at a perfect 90 degrees very easily. These little clamps here just swing in and nip the wood up tight. They've got a little arch just here, which means that they grip the timber about central as opposed to sort of skewing it over to one side. Now that's set, that looks very nice. That's all nice and tight. What I'm going to do now is hold this little butterfly key quite firmly with my thumb and then just put some quite gentle knife lines all the way around. And the reason for going gently is just to make sure that I haven't got any chance of moving this little chappie as I mark out its position. Okay, we've talked about a bit of extra space each side, and the easiest way of doing that is to get a pencil and just use a pencil thickness just on the end there, just to make a mark. That'll give me about a millimetre or less, which is about right. That's the pencil marks in. So I'll mark the joint now. On this side, I'll mark it A and B. And just for continuity of positioning of this, I'll mark this A and B as well on top. Because when I do the other side, I'll mark that up differently, just so I know which one goes where. Okay. Right, I'll take this out now and transfer the lines across to the other side. I'm going to use a little dovetail template for this as a small square because it works really nicely. And what I want to do is pick up the lines with my knife. And I can see one just here. So I'll just pick that up and I'll transfer that across. Okay. Now, the next thing I need to do is just deepen these lines a little bit on this side. So I'll pop this back in the vise again. And I'll just go in with a knife and pick up the lines I put in previously and make them a little bit deeper. So there's one. And there's the second. What I need to do now is pick up the pencil line and transfer the right-hand side of this pencil line over to the other side of the workpiece to make sure I've got a consistent depth from one side to the next. I'll use a cutting gauge for that, and I'll set that very carefully to the outside of my pencil line. Okay, now that's bang on. Now make sure you've got plenty of light here because you need to really see what you're doing and work accurately. Okay, that's set. I'm just going to stretch a little line now. Okay, and I'll transfer the same line now to the other side. To do that, I'll just estimate where that little slot's going to be. And it's going to be somewhere around between here and there. Approximately. So just put that line on down there. There we go. Okay, the next thing to do is to saw out the waste, and I'll do that with a dovetail saw. Now the next part of the job is a very standard dovetailing operation, and so I'll just cut the waste out now with a dovetail saw, and you've got to work pretty accurately now. Just follow your lines really carefully. And stop just before the bottom of your mark there, because you can always pare out a little bit deeper with your chisel if you need to. Right, just cut the other side. Right, the next job is just to take the waste out, and you could do that with just a chisel, and that's the way we showed you in Working Wood 1 and 2. But I'm going to use a coping saw for this because it's really quick. And the trick is always not to go below your line, but just go close to it. What I'll do now is take the chisel and just pare the waste out. Now, what you do need for this is a very sharp chisel. Otherwise, what you'll end up doing is just tearing the grain and not actually cutting it neatly. I'm using a 1/4-inch chisel here. Make sure you clean out the corners really nicely, because just a little bit in the corners will actually stop the dovetail key from going in. And just pare through from this side only, a little over halfway to start off with, and then you can check if the dovetail key fits. And we'll just try them in for size. Wriggle that in there now. And that fits quite nicely. He's tightening about there somewhere. He will go a bit further, but that's good. So that's fine. I know he fits. Now, the next part of the job is to do exactly the same thing on the other part of the moulding. Just as before, use exactly the same layout procedure. Transfer the layout lines across the mitered face to the other side of the workpiece. Next, use your cutting gauge to define the end of the dovetailed slot and transfer the same measurement to the other side of the slot. With the workpiece turned over, estimate the position of your dovetailed slot and mark this with a pencil. This allows you to gauge out the slot depth in the right place. Use a marking knife to carefully deepen the lines defining the sides of the dovetailed slot. Use a dovetail saw and then a coping saw to remove the waste. Clean up the slot with a sharp chisel and take your time. It's worth getting a really good fit. Bring both sides of the mitered joint together and gently press the butterfly key in, locking both pieces together. After this, it's back to the marking out jig, so pop this back into your vise. Clamp up your half-jointed moulding in place with the butterfly key you've just fitted on the underside. This makes it very easy to take your second butterfly key, hold it steady exactly where it needs to go, and knife round the shape, just as before. Don't forget to mark up the orientation of the butterfly key, as each side of the slot is made to measure. Separate the pieces and pop them back into the vise so you can chisel out the slot exactly to the lines you've just marked. Check that the key fits nicely before you work on the other piece. When you are happy with the last slot, reassemble the joint on the bench and check how it all fits. Remember, don't push the keys in too tight, as you'll need to take the joint apart and glue it up before you're finished. When the glue's dry, saw off the keys almost flush with the workpiece and then finish them off with a plane.
Okay. That's the last of my four butterfly keys, all plain flush now. So I'll just take it out of the clamp. And this is a really useful way of producing a nice strong joint, because the butterfly key has the advantage of pulling the joint together without needing any kind of specialist clamps as it's gluing up. So the taper I cut on here is all it takes to produce a surprising amount of clamping pressure across the join. So to assemble the finished moulding, you simply glue together the cove and the overlay like that, and that'll give you a lovely cornice. And it's really that easy. In the next video, I've got another method for reinforcing the corner joint, which is really fast. And I'll see you then.